So in this video, I'll basically be deriving this expression. But before I get into the derivation of this expression, I need to explain some background information regarding how we arrived to this expression coming up. Now, in our previous sessions, we discussed the first law of thermodynamics, and in this, we were able to illustrate using a real gas. Now, here is one thing about the real gas. A real gas has randomly moving particles whose average velocity gives us the measure of the kinetic energy, and it also has intermolecular forces of attraction between the molecules. The measure of the intermolecular forces of attraction gives us the potential energy of the gas. So as far as a real gas is concerned, when we add the potential energy and the kinetic energy together, we get what we call the internal energy of the gas. We discussed this concept in our previous session when we were trying to explain the first law of thermodynamics. Now, if I may speak about a real gas, we have oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and so forth. These gases have different behavioral characteristics, and so it becomes a bit tricky to get one single equation that can be used to deal with all of them. Now, this is where the ideal gas comes in. What is an ideal gas? An ideal gas is simply a theoretical or a hypothetical model of a gas. This theoretical model is what we use to derive the necessary equations we shall be using from now on. Now, here are some characteristics of an ideal gas. Number one, an ideal gas has molecules whose volume is negligible compared to the volume of the entire gas, meaning that the molecules of an ideal gas are just mere dots. They are looked at as just points. So the volume occupied by the individual particles of an ideal gas is negligible compared to the volume of the entire gas. That is the volume of the ideal gas. That is one distinct characteristic of an ideal gas. For a real gas, there are intermolecular forces of attraction between the molecules. But then for an ideal gas, there are no intermolecular forces of attraction between the molecules. That's another distinct characteristic of an ideal gas. Now, when you get a real gas and you subject it to very high temperatures and low pressure, the heat will weaken these intermolecular forces of attraction. So these intermolecular forces of attraction will weaken so much that there will no longer be any forces in between the molecules. This simply means that when real gases are subject to conditions of very high temperature and low pressure, they start behaving like ideal gases, or they start adopting characteristics of ideal gases. So this means that a real gas can be approximated to an ideal gas if you subject it to conditions of very high temperature and low pressure. Now, if you may first get back to the law of thermodynamics, we said in our previous session, we said that the internal energy of a gas is the summation of the kinetic energies and the potential energies of the particles of that gas. But remember, for an ideal gas, there are no intermolecular forces of attraction. So if an ideal gas does not have forces between the particles, it simply means that if we are to get that internal energy of an ideal gas, it's going to be the kinetic energy, which is the measure of the velocity of the particles that are moving around. But then the potential energy is zero. So it means when we are talking about an ideal gas, the potential energy of an ideal gas is equal to zero. Why is that? So before we go ahead and start deriving the internal energy of an ideal gas, it is important for us to take note that when it comes to an ideal gas, the internal energy is equivalent to the kinetic energy of the gas. Because when it comes to the internal energy of an ideal gas, the potential energy does not exist because there are no intermolecular forces of attraction between the particles. So all the internal energy is equivalent to the kinetic energy. So for us to start deriving this expression, which represents the internal energy of an ideal gas, we are going to use a certain diagram to help us. So right before us, we have a cuboid. This cuboid has got it's a cube, it has the same side, L, 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 so meaning the length is L, the width is also L, the height is also L. Now, in here, inside this box, inside this cuboid, we are having particles, air particles. And now, of all the air particles that are inside this cuboid, we are going to just single out one of them, which so happens to be that one. Now, this particle is going to move, and it is going to collide with this wall. We've called this wall X. So it's going to collide and with wall X. When it collides with wall X, it's going to get back to where it has been. So it means as this particle is moving to come and collide with wall X and go back, it's going to move through a certain distance L to collide, and then it's going to come back to that point, to this other wall, through the same distance L, and it's going to be moving along X. Now, if you look at our derivation, for us to get to R times T, we are going to use the formula for pressure, and we know that pressure is, by definition, is the force acting normally per unit area. So we know that pressure is going to be equal to force over area, like that. So we are going to substitute this equation to help us get the kinetic energy of this particle. So how do we begin? Of course, we are looking at this particle. All this thing is in reference to this particle. The amount of pressure that is being exerted by this particle on this wall X. So when this particle moves and collides with this wall X, it's colliding on this wall whose area will be, the length here is L and the width here is also L. So the area of this particle here, the area of this wall is L squared. As simple as that. So we have sorted the issue of area. Now let's go ahead and find F, the force that this particle is exerting on this wall as it's coming, as it collides with the wall. What is that force? So now we are going to look deeper into that force from first principles. Now from first principles, we know that by definition, a force is directly proportional to the rate of change of momentum of this particle. This is coming from Newton's second law of motion. We know that Newton's second law of motion states that the rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the force applied, and it takes place in the direction of the force. So it means that this particle, as it is coming, it is going to hit this wall and then go back. When it does so, the force that is applied, the force by which it's going to hit this, is directly proportional to the rate of change of momentum of that particle. So for us to get that value of F, the force F, we know that F is going to be equal to the rate of change of momentum. We are getting that from Newton's second law of motion. So the rate of change of momentum is given by mass times the initial m times u. Now this is velocity in the x direction. So we are going to be u x minus mass times final. So after it has collided this wall and it's coming back, so mass times the final velocity x. But now take note that this velocity is a vector quantity. When it's moving in this direction, that is positive. Now when it hits the wall and it gets back, on hitting the wall and then getting back, this velocity changes direction. So it means that this velocity here, the final velocity as the thing is coming back, will be negative, like that. So it means this is all divide that by time, because it is rate of change of momentum. So it means this is going to become mux minus, now this minus can come here, minus negative m u x, divide all that by t. This becomes positive. This is m. Now, of course, when it comes to that, this becomes m times mass of the particle times the velocity of the particle in the x direction plus mass of the particle times the velocity in the x direction, divide that by time. So here we are having the force being equivalent to 2m, 2 times mass of the particle times the velocity of the particle in the x direction, divide that by time. So we can go ahead and express this time in terms of the parameters here. Now if we may do our side work, we know that time is given by distance over speed. We are trying to substitute for this value of t. So if time is given by distance over speed, if you look at this particle, when it moves from this end of the wall and it goes and bashes into this one and goes back, it first travels a distance of L from here, from this end to that end. Then it comes back again and it travels another distance L to get back here. So it means in total, the distance of this particle to move, to collide to this wall and come back is 2L. So it means that the distance traveled there is 2L, divide that by speed. Now the speed with which it's moving, it's definitely the velocity and it's in the x direction. So the speed here is ux. So it means that the time here is, which the speed here is ux. 2L over ux is going to give us the time. So it means we are going to substitute for this expression of time right there. So it means if we are to continue here, our expression there for now has become 2m u x, divide that by time, which so happens to be that 2l over u x. When we divide this by that, this becomes, it means our value of F, the force, is going to be equal to 2m u x squared, divide all that by 2l. So these values of 2 will cancel out. And so when they cancel out, of course, we have our value of F remaining as mass times velocity in the x direction squared over L. That's our force. So at this stage, if we are to look back at where we started from, we need an expression for A area, which we already got at the very beginning, then an expression for F, which we have got right here. If you are to bring this thing back to substitute it from pressure is equal to force over area, this is now what we have. Pressure is going to be force over area. So that is going to be equal to our expression for force is mu squared m u x squared over L. Divide that by area. Now our value of area, we got it earlier as L squared. So divide that by L squared. So we shall end up with m u x squared over L to the power 3. That is our pressure now, our expression for pressure. Now, L to the power 3 is L times L times L. And we know that L times L times L, when we look at this, is equivalent to the volume of this box. So this turns into m u x squared, divide that by our volume. So if I may rewrite this more properly, it becomes our P pressure is going to be m u x squared over V. And this is the same as saying PV is going to be m u x squared. Now let's take note of one thing. This is mass times velocity in the x direction. But now remember that we are having this particle. We are only considering this particle that moving in the dimension only in the x direction. But this particle could move in the y direction. It could also move in the z direction. So it means that we need to find the effective velocity of this particle in all these three directions. So to find the resultant velocity or the effective or the resultant velocity of this particle in all the three directions, this is what we shall do. So if this is the particle and it is having velocity, it can move in the x, y, and z directions. To get the resultant velocity, which we shall call c, we call the resultant velocity c squared, is going to be equal to the velocity in the x direction plus the velocity in the y direction plus the velocity in the z direction to get this value of c. To get the resultant velocity of this particle is the velocity in the x, y, and z. Now this particle is moving randomly, and because it's moving randomly, it could move at any speed. Remember, this particle is together with so many other particles that are constantly colliding with each other, and they are constantly moving randomly in all directions, in the x direction, in the y direction, in the x direction. So it means we are going to assume that the speed, the mean square speed in the x direction is the same as the mean square speed in the y direction, and it is the same as the mean square speed in the z direction. So if we are assuming that these speeds are the same because the particles are too many and they are moving randomly, or even if it's just one particle and it is moving randomly, it means in whether it's moving in the x direction or in the y direction or in the z direction, the particles, the speed in all these directions will be the same. So if it's going to be the same, it means that ux, the mean squared speed in the x direction, is equal to the mean squared speed in the y direction. It's also the same as the mean squared speed in the z direction, like that. So if we are to, if these speeds are the same in all the directions, if we are to bring, apply this in this previous statement, it means that our resultant velocity, which we have denoted as c squared, is going to be equal to u x squared plus, now uy is the same as ux, so we can as well say u x squared, which is the same as saying plus uz also is the same as ux, so it is the same as also u x squared. This is going to become our mean square, our resultant. The resultant velocity of the particle is going to be equal to 1, 2, 3. 3 ux squared. And so if we make ux the subject of the formula, divide both sides by 3, it means that our ux in this case is the same as a third c squared. C being the effective velocity of the particle in all the directions. So if we are to substitute for ux in our expression here, this is what this is going to become. It means our PV here, PV is going to be equal to the mass, which is m, times ux squared. Now our ux squared, if you're expressing this in terms of the effective velocity, it's going to become times a third c squared. So if you look at this expression, this becomes PV is going to be equal to a third MC squared. A third MC squared, if we shift 3 to make this a flat equation, it becomes 3PV is going to be equal to MC squared. Now if you look at this thing, 3PV being equal to MC squared, this is mass times velocity squared. Now mass times velocity squared, if you realize, it looks like the expression for kinetic energy. We know the expression for kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is given by a half times mass times velocity squared. A half MC squared. And now if you compare this expression for kinetic energy and this MC squared, we have MC squared there, we have MC squared there, and what is lacking is just this a half. So what we do to make this expression look like this one, so that here we have kinetic energy, we just multiply a half on both sides. So we shall come here and say, multiply this times a half, and we multiply the same this way, times a half, so that this now becomes kinetic energy. So it means that this is going to become a half MC squared is going to be equal to 3 over 2 PV. So this is the kinetic energy here. So it means that's how we come to the conclusion that kinetic energy is going to be equal to 3 over 2 PV. We all know that the equation of an ideal gas, PV, is going to be equal to nRT. So it means that much as this is equal to 3 over 2 PV, this can also be expressed as 3 over 2. In the place of PV, we put nRT. nRT. So at the end of the day, that is how we're able to derive the kinetic energy of an ideal gas, which is 3 over 2 nRT. This brings us to the end of this video. Thanks for watching. Feel free to check out other excellent videos on the channel and don't forget to subscribe. For Kisembo Academy, this is Arnold Rangakuramia helping you manifest excellence.